Well, thank you. And I'm happy to be here to support James Risen and to encourage the Department of Justice to stop its efforts to compel him to testify. At the Reporters Committee, we've been actively involved in this case from the start, and we've been working with the department on reform of its own guidelines regarding media subpoenas. And while that certainly can feel like a Sisyphean task, it nonetheless is critical to engage with the government on these issues. Even incremental progress is something. But ultimately, threats like these from the federal government must be addressed by enactment of a meaningful shield law that recognizes that reporters need to be independent of the judicial system, not because they're above the law or because they want to avoid the burden of participating in the legal system, but because journalists need that independence to truly help hold the government accountable to the people. The Reporters Committee was founded in 1970 over this very issue, the threats to reporters from subpoenas that led to the Brandsburg v. Hayes case and the need for a federal shield law. In the decade that followed, there were almost 100 journalist shield bills introduced in Congress. The effort was taken up again in earnest after the Valerie Plame incident, in which New York Times reporter Judith Miller eventually spent 85 days in jail for refusing to disclose her confidential sources. Those shield law efforts that started then are ongoing. It takes a while to get these things through Congress. In 2007, the House overwhelmingly approved a shield bill. And when that didn't pass through the Senate in 2009, a similar bill passed on a voice vote under a suspension of the rules, meaning it was so non-controversial that a roll call vote wasn't even needed. The Senate hasn't passed such a bill yet, but in 2009, the Judiciary Committee did send a bill to the floor. It failed to win a place on the calendar as debate on something called Obamacare suddenly took over the agenda. That kind of sidetracked things for a while. But the latest attempt at passage of a journalist shield bill came after last summer's disclosures of a massive subpoena of the Associated Press's phone records to track down a leak about a CIA operation in Yemen, and the revelation that the Department of Justice had successfully obtained a search warrant of a Fox News reporter's Gmail account by saying that he was involved in a crime, by telling a court in order to get the search warrant, that he was involved in a crime, quote, at the very least, either as an aider, abettor, and or co-conspirator, end quote. That was really something for the government to come out and say, a reporter, by asking a source, asking a government employee for information, was guilty of aiding, abetting, or co-conspiring in an espionage charge, what is essentially an espionage charge. So when the actions against AP and Fox News came to light, President Obama ordered Attorney General Holder to review policies for subpoenas of journalists' work, and a policy statement was released as a report to the president in July of last year. And while the media representatives involved in that process fought for provisions that would make such efforts more difficult for prosecutors and at least lead to greater notifications to journalists before their third-party records were subpoenaed, we knew at the same time that, of course, the Department of Justice was saying that it fully intended to subpoena reporters in the future if they really needed the evidence to prosecute a leaker. The AP and Fox News incidents also prompted more congressional action on a shield bill, and a bill was approved by the Senate Judiciary Committee last September, so almost a year ago now, although it still awaits Senate floor action. The House hasn't taken up the legislation at all yet this year, and of course the current makeup of the House is not quite the same as it was in 2009, so we don't know what will happen there. But the fight over the right to keep journalist sources confidential is literally older than the Republic. John Peter Zenger, a colonial printer, refused to disclose the authors of attacks against the colonial governor of New York in 1734, and thus was himself charged with seditious libel. A century later, in 1848, news of the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo, ending the Mexican-American War, was first reported to the American people after a newspaper reporter, John Nugent of the New York Herald, was told of the still-secret terms. Nugent spent a month basically under house arrest in the Capitol. 50 years after that, in 1896, John Morris, a Baltimore Sun reporter, reported that a number of elected officials and police officers were taking payoffs from gambling houses. when he refused to name his source before a grand jury, he was imprisoned until the grand jury's term expired. The significance of this case is that this jailing prompted Baltimore journalists to push for the then unheard of legislation that would protect them from having to reveal sources' identities in court, a reporter's privilege, much like the spousal privilege or the doctor-patient privilege. The statute has been amended a few times, but the state has never felt the need to rescind the protection. And in the century since then, we've now seen another 38 states and the District of Columbia enact such shield laws. It is those state shield laws that provide the real protections to journalists, as the right at the federal level is weaker than ever. Thanks to the state efforts, we know that shield laws work. Now more than ever, it is time to demand that Congress pass a meaningful shield law. Congress must act now and acknowledge that the government's accountability to the people comes primarily through independent watchdogs, including not just journalists, but whistleblowers as well. One of the greatest things those in power can do is enact limits on their own powers. And Congress must take that bold step now. Thank you.